si chiede se la presentazione è in inglese. A questo punto possiamo
dire. Certo.
Ok, so let's start. We can at this point we can switch to the English. We are very happy to have Chiara Punzo e Lorenza Rossi for this, I suppose, ninth webinar of the Italian Economic Association. This webinar will be coordinated by the chair is Marcello Signorelli. Marcello, the presentation is yours.
Thanks, Alberto.
Marcello, are you there?
Yes. Just a very short presentation. Chiara Punzo is a macroeconomist at Bank of France. She was a young researcher at the Faculty of Banking and Insurance of the University of Milan. He takes the PhD in economics in 2016. Most important research interest regards monetary policies, both applied and theory, and macroprudential monetary policy, and not only monetary policies. She's very young, as you can see, but she already published several working papers and some also in some journals. I just mentioned the publication on the Journal of Economic Behavior and Organization. As for Lorenza Rossi, she is Associate Professor of Economics at the Department of Economics of the University of Pavia. As for the research interest, they are again monetary policy, the analysis of the economic cycle in with heterogeneous agents. She has already several excellent publications in top journal. I just mentioned two of the top journal where she published, the European Economic Review and the Economic Journal. So Chiara Punzo will present all the paper, and then after 40 minutes, we will start with the Q&A function, so participants can suggest questions or comment about the presentation. Chiara, please.
Okay. Can you see now the presentation? Okay. Okay, the direct economic effect, I want to present this working paper coherently with the COVID crisis that we are facing, and also with the issue, the main issue of this seminar. The direct economic effect that we expect from coronavirus come from both sides of the Marshallian scissors, so the demand side and the supply side. On the supply side, the direct effect were immediate. So we registered an availability of inputs, and so the decline of production and sales. The direct effect on the demand side are slower to come, but at the end are the most prolonged because they involve changes in preferences. In this paper, this model is particularly focused on the demand side, but in our future research, we want to also to implement the supply side of this model to understand better what can be the impact of a supply side shock like coronavirus in this type of, which interacts with this type of policies. So in any case, the direct effect which come from both sides of the Marshallian scissors lead to a decline of employment, a loss of income, and consequently a decline of consumption and of welfare. So many receipts will be have been proposed during these COVID times, and the first one was a major role by the banking sector, in the sense that the banking sector could provide loans in an easy way. But we know that we already know this story, and we know that this type of receipt can increase the probability of default, not only for firms, but also for banks. And we don't want that in an economic crisis due to an health emergency would be transformed in a financial crisis. The second receipt, which was proposed, was an increase of taxes. But we know that this measure of austerity in bad times period can increase the ratio, the debt to GDP ratio, and they can further depress aggregate demand, particularly in Southern Europe countries which were the most involved in this COVID crisis. The third proposal was an increase of public debt, but also this measure, it's a risk strategy, especially in countries in which register an already high debt to GDP ratio. This is we have to recognize that without the guarantee that the European Commission and the European Central Bank provided during these times, the spread would run much faster. And also, if we want to talk about the quantitative easing operation, which were adopted also before the COVID times, so the massive purchase of newly issued debt by the central bank, we have to say that they can only partially help, but because they cannot prevent the increase of debt to GDP ratio. This is the reason why some economists, also Italian economists, have proposed alternative receipts, alternative fiscal and monetary stimuli for this period. And for example, the Boitani, Saraceno, and Tamburini, but also Giavazzi and Tabellini on La Voce, have proposed the issue of redeemable or very long maturity euro bonds backed by the ECB to keep the financing burden low. And at the same time, Jordi Galí on Voxeo has proposed to provide struggling firms with funds without raising their financial liability. And in practice, we can say that this measure, it's a subsidies, it's for firms, are tax reliefs. The first proposal by Boitani, but also Giavazzi and Tabellini, at the end, it's again an increase of public debt, also if it's a very low interest rate. The second proposal by Jordi Galí is based on a scientific, as I said, on a scientific paper just published on Journal of Monetary Economics. In this paper, he compares the money financed government expenditure increase with a money financed tax tax cut, so at the end transfer. In normal times and in a zero lower bound scenario. And he compares these results with the results of a benchmark DSG model to analyze monetary and fiscal policy, which is a model in which the monetary authority adopts an inflation targeting rule and the fiscal measure are financed by the issuance of public debt. But this work, which was born in 2014, It's based on a representative agent New Keynesian model. This is the reason why few months after the presentation of the first version of this work of Jordi Galí, we decided to analyze how this result can change when we introduce a two-agent New Keynesian model. So we introduce the presence of heterogeneity among agents, in particular two agents, so the presence only of two agents like borrowers and savers. Because our research question were the presence of a borrower-saver framework can change the effectiveness of this measure. And also if the effectiveness of this measure of money financed government expenditure increase and money financed transfer depend on the state of the economy. So what is the structure of our working paper? We consider a borrower-saver framework as presented by Delby, Monacelli and Perotti on Economic Journal in 2013, where agents differ in their degree of impatience. What does it mean? It means that they have a different discount factor, in particular the savers discount factors is higher than the borrower's one. And both agents are intertemporal maximizer. This is the first difference with respect to a rule of thumb scenario. So both agents are intertemporal maximizers. And in this framework, borrowing and lending take place also in equilibrium. Why? Because the difference of the spread between the discount factor is present also in equilibrium. And this is the reason why borrowing and lending take place also in equilibrium. And financial markets are imperfect also in equilibrium in the sense that borrowers face a suitable defined borrowing limit. And this type of framework of a two-agent New Keynesian model is different from the rule of thumb scenario because the impact of policies is also on the distribution of debt and saving across agents. So there is a feedback effect of the borrowing constraint influenced by monetary and fiscal policy on the macroeconomic scenario. And the roadmap of the paper is to analyze the differences between the redistribution channel of what we call an helicopter drop, which is a simple increase of money, monetary policy, in shock of money supply, positive shock of money supply, and the redistribution channel of a money finance government expenditure increase. And then I will explain the meaning of this comparison, technically speaking. Then we to understand the power of this redistribution channel in these two policy scenarios, we go to compare the aggregate results of the two agents New Keynesian model with the results which come from a representative agent model. So we go to analyze these two policies in a representative agent New Keynesian model. And then we repeat this analysis in a zero lower bound scenario to highlight the differences with normal times. Okay, what are our results? We find that the effectiveness of the two instruments, so a money finance government expenditure increase and an helicopter drop, depend on the redistributive effects and also on the state of the economy. And a government spending financed through money creation is more effective in a zero lower bound scenario than in normal times. So the power of this instrument is particularly important in a zero lower bound scenario. while an helicopter drop is the most effective one in normal times. Okay, what is the literature we refer to? As I have said, the paper of Galli, the preliminary version of the paper of, which was published on Journal of Monetary Economics inspired us. And this is, as I have explained, this is the reason why it's the scientific basis on which he proposed recently the unrepayable funding by the central bank of additional fiscal transfer. And he called this additional fiscal transfer helicopter money. Then when I will explain technically this point, I will say the differences between the policy presented by Galli and the theoretical definition of an helicopter money. In any case, Masciandaro, also in these webinars on COVID of Italian Economic Society, reprised that this transfer produced distributional effects and conflicts between politicians and central bankers. In particular, if government and church are focused on career-concerned politicians and there is heterogeneity among citizens. There is another important relevant analysis on money-financed fiscal stimuli by English and López-Salido et al., which say that these money-financed fiscal programs, if communicated successfully and credible by the public, can provide a significant stimulus. But except for the recent analysis of Masciandaro, the other analysis, the analysis of Jordi Galli and the analysis of English et al., are analysis in a representative agent, New Keynesian model. So, but there is the empirical evidence. In particular, I want to cite the analysis of Sterk and Torreiro, which say that the redistribution channel and the non-Ricardian effects have a role in the interplay of monetary and fiscal policy, and they provide an empirical evidence of such interaction by documenting a substantial response of public debt to monetary policy. Because the introduction of heterogeneity gives a key role to the dynamics of public debt, also if this type of policies are not financed by public debt. So what is the reason why we thought that redistributive effect were fundamental when we analyze a money finance fiscal stimulus? Because a money finance fiscal stimulus increase for sure prices and not so much as we expect, but increase price, and it increases the nominal balance sheet of debtors and creditors. And the increase of this nominal balance sheet added to the decrease of the real interest rate due to the increase of inflation creates what Auclert in 2019 called nominal creditors as losers and nominal debtors as gainers. This transmission channel that I have cited, it's what he calls the Fisher channel. So this transmission channel makes debtors as gainers, thanks to the role of inflation. And in addition, Koibion say that in 2017, that a low-income agent more than proportionately benefit from increases in aggregate income. Analyzing monetary policy shock in a paper that most of you already know. So this is the reason why the motivation, the empirical motivation, why we proposed to introduce a two-agent New Keynesian model to analyze a money finance fiscal stimuli. So in our model, there are two types of households, savers. I don't prefer to show equation because maybe they can be confusing, but in any case, I sum up what this equation, the budget constraint of savers and borrowers say. Savers hold private assets because there is a private market between borrowers and saver, financial private market. Of private asset, then they hold one period public bond, riskless public bonds, and they hold shares in intermediate good firms. And obviously they consume and they work. While borrowers, they work, they consume, and they face a borrowing constraint at all times, also in city state, as I've said. Forms are very standard, and this is the part of the model, obviously, we want to implement also to analyze a supply side shock like COVID. The fiscal authority, the government budget constraint of the fiscal authority, it's shows that public expenditure can be financed by the issuance of public bonds, the increasing of the taxes and the issuance of and money creation, what we call seigniorage, money creation by the central bank. Now, in the two stimuli that we go to show, monetary authority plays a different role. In the case of money financed government expenditure increase, the supply of money by the central bank is endogenous. So the fiscal measure is financed but requires an amount of money which is guaranteed by the central bank. In the second case, the case of an helicopter drop, so a direct transfer to households, in this case, the amount of money creation is decided exogenously by the central bank. So this is the first important difference. But if we want to see technically the meaning of this difference, the model is the same, only two equations change. When we, first of all, what is the definition of a money financed government expenditure, of a money financed fiscal stimuli according to Jordi Galli? It's a regime in which seigniorage is adjusted every period in order to keep the real debt unchanged. So you can understand that in this definition, also inflation plays a crucial role. Because if the variation of nominal debt is equal to the variation of inflation, the variation of the real public debt is equal to zero. And it's sufficient to say that this fiscal measure is money financed. Obviously, the creation of money required in this model depends from the characteristics of the model also. So the presence of heterogeneity, so the redistribution channels, and also on this scenario. So simply we have these two equations, a very standard fiscal shock, an AR1 fiscal shock, and this equation, so the value, the real value of public debt remains constant. This is the difference between our paper and the paper of Jordi Galli, in the sense that he analyzes money finance fiscal stimuli and also the transport, imposing that the real public debt is equal to zero. This is the reason why in this scientific paper we cannot call the fiscal transfer as an helicopter drop, because when we talk about an helicopter drop, the role of the government is absent at first point, in the sense that simply the money rains from the sky and it can have different effects on public debt, but it's a secondary effect. While when we talk about money financed government expenditure increase or money financed fiscal transfer, the role of the government is primary, in the sense that we have to be sure that these fiscal measures are financed only by money creation, keeping the real value of public debt equal to zero, to be sure that there is no intervention by the public debt, but only by money creation. So this, I hope to be clear about the difference between an helicopter drop and money finance fiscal stimuli. So to analyze an helicopter drop, we simply substitute the equation one, saying that there is no fiscal stimulus, so imposing the fiscal shock equal to zero. And we substitute the equation two with an AIR-1 process on money. So what are our results? Here we analyze a 1% increase of government expenditure financed by money creation and a 1% increase of money. The first one is the violet line with diamonds, and the second one is the pink line with circles. And you can see that the effects are very similar, less than 0.5% in normal times. Why? Because on impact, the effects of a money financed government expenditure increase is higher because we have two component that increase, the private consumption and public expenditure. But at the end, the helicopter drop is the most prolonged, thanks to the impact that an helicopter drop has on inflation. Because you can see the inflation increases much more. Why? Because inside a money financed government expenditure increase that we analyze with the violet line, there are two components. One component is a pure fiscal stimulus, and the second component is a monetary stimulus. Now we know that a pure fiscal stimulus has a crowding out effect on saver consumption. So this crowding out effect on savers consumption pushes down the impulse response function of aggregate consumption when we analyze a money financed government expenditure increase with respect to an helicopter drop. So this is the reason why the increase, when we analyze an helicopter drop, the increase of aggregate consumption is larger, because the reaction of savers is larger than when we analyze a money financed government expenditure increase. And this figure show what I am saying. Okay, you can see that when we have a money financed government expenditure increase, the input response on savers consumption is very low with respect to this response when we analyze an helicopter drop, thanks to the crowding out effect on saver consumption that a fiscal stimulus has, which is a component of a money financed government expenditure increase. And if we want to measure the redistribution channel by the ratio between borrower consumption and saver consumption, We see that this redistribution effect is very similar among the two measures in normal times, but at the end, thanks to the effect on inflation, the effect of an helicopter drop is more persistent. Then, in this figure, we go to analyze the dotted line is the response that we have in each model when we consider a representative agent in the Keynesian model. What is a representative agent in the Keynesian model? It's a model in which the share of savers is 100%, while in the two agents in the Keynesian model that we analyze, the share of savers is 75%. So you can see that there is a redistribution channel, both when we analyze output and consumption, and both for when we analyze an helicopter money, but also when we analyze money finance government expenditure increase, there is this redistribution channel and it measures no more than 0.5% in normal times. Then we go to analyze welfare. Okay, to analyze welfare, to numerically evaluate the welfare, we solve the model using a second order approximation of the structural equation, and we compute the individual welfare for borrowers and for savers. And the social welfare is a weighted sum of the individual welfare of each different kind of households. So a weighted sum, so the weight are the share of borrowers and the share of savers. Now, given the utility function is not cardinal, a welfare measure based on the value function is not revealing. This is the reason why we convert the welfare measures in consumption equivalent units and define it as the constant fraction of consumption under an helicopter drop. That household should give away in each period to equate the value function under a money financed government expenditure increase. So if this measure is positive, it means that for the agent is better an helicopter drop. If it's negative, it means that for this agent is better a money financed government expenditure increase is better. So these are our results. What is D? D is the amount of borrowing. So when the amount of borrowing is zero, it means that we are analyzing a rule of thumb agent. So this agent cannot borrow. They simply spend how much they simply spend what they gain. Then we have the case in which the borrowing is 0.5 and the case in which they can borrow as they want. So 100%. And so in this case, the borrowing constraint is relaxed. Now you can see that the borrower, the effect on borrower gain from an helicopter drop more than money financed fiscal stimulus in normal times. And this gain increases when we obviously relax the borrowing constraint. For savers, it's the opposite. They lose in an helicopter drop more than how much they lose under a money financed government increase. And this loss increases when we relax the borrowing constraint. And the gain for borrowers is so large that it more than compensates also if they are fewer than savers in share terms, their gain is so large by this policy measure that it more than compensate the loss of savers. And at the end, the aggregate result represents the same tendency of the borrower tendency. So the aggregate results increases when we relax the borrowing constraint. Then we can say that, and all these dynamics, the crucial factor is the behavior of inflation that I have explained before. And we can also say that thanks to the impact that inflation has on borrowing constraint. And this result on the representative agent New Keynesian model is positive. What does it mean? It means that also when we analyze a representative agent model, an helicopter drop is better than, because obviously it is better than a money financed government expenditure increase. But in this case, in aggregate terms, we can say that it underestimates the result of a two-agent New Keynesian model. Because you see the result in a two-agent New Keynesian model are much higher than the result in a representative agent New Keynesian model. Now, we go to the analysis in a zero lower bound scenario. Okay, what does it happen in a zero lower bound scenario? We have an adverse demand shock, which pushes the nominal interest, the interest rate, the natural interest rate into a negative territory. And then we had some alternative policy measures. And these are, in the case of a money-financed government expenditure increase, we see it's the money-financed government expenditure increase is the only one to prevent recession. Why? Because the injection of liquidity, that a 1% increase of government expenditure requires, is so high that it prevents the economy to enter into a recession, thanks to the impact that it has on inflation. The 1% increase of money supply, also when agents hold money, so it's a direct transfer to them, is not enough to prevent the recession. Indeed, and it's also explained by the fact that this inflation has on the real interest rate. As you can see also the impact that this increase on real interest rate has on public debt in the case of a 1% increase in money supply, 1% helicopter drop. The impact of inflation has obviously a larger impact on borrower consumption. Also, if it's not enough to increase saver consumption, so there, in any case, we have a crowding out effect on savers' consumption. But the effect on borrower consumption is so high that the redistribution channel of a money-financed government expenditure increase is much higher in a zero lower bound scenario. And the last interesting point, I believe, it's the comparison between the analysis of these policies in a representative agent New Keynesian model and a two-agent New Keynesian model. Because you see that if we analyze a representative agent New Keynesian model, as in the case of Galili, a money-financed government expenditure increase is not enough to prevent the recession. Why? Because here we understand that the driving forces of our results are heterogeneity, but and the scenario. So the driving force of a money finance government expenditure increase are the presence of heterogeneity of financial constraints and the zero lower bound on nominal interest rate. This is not the case when we analyze a 1% increase of money, because it's not enough to prevent the recession. Also, if we analyze a two-agent new Keynesian model. So I prefer to stop here and answer to the answer in a better way to possible question that I hope.
Thank you, Chiara, for your excellent presentation, interesting paper. I invite participants to suggest the comments and questions. The first one, maybe also you, Chiara, can read in Q&A, and I invite the other participants to suggest questions and comments. The first one I read, could you better explain how the crowding out effect of public spending on private consumption works if public spending is not financed via debt, and therefore I presume it does not have effect on the real interest rate, if not via inflation. On top of this, I would assume that the lower real interest rate should stimulate current consumption rather than crowding out. Chiara. And also Lorenza, if she wants, can contribute to reply.
Okay. Lower interest rate in reality is okay. So I go to the slide. I don't know if Lorenza wants to answer. I leave the floor to Lorenza. Otherwise, I try to answer. Okay, the reason is in the behavior of the real interest rate. So, and it's also on what I have said before, the Fisher channel explained by Oakley, in the sense that if the real interest rate decreases for savers, the gains for saver are so, there is an income effect for savers is so low that they prefer to consume less. The reason is that we cannot see transparently the crowding out effect, because in this slide I don't show the effect of a fiscal. What I'm saying is that there is a crowding out on saver consumption, also if at the end saver consumption increases. Okay, as you can see. But there is the fiscal stimulus inside a money finance government expenditure increase, which is characterized by a crowding out effect. And the reason is that there is an upward pressure on nominal interest rate when we analyze a pure fiscal stimulus, and this upward pressure on nominal interest rate explains why savers are less optimistic than borrowers.
Maybe Alberto was asking about the zero lower bound or in normal time.
Because no, I think they want to know about the crowding out effect. While there is a crowding out effect,
zero lower bound, because in normal time there is a crowding in effect.
No, because I have talked about crowding out effect, which is
zero lower bound. The last slide here is crowding in.
Also in normal times, which is the reason why savers the impulse response function of savers in slide 9 is lower than the, when we analyze harmonic finance government expenditure increase, is lower than the input response function when we analyze. Why? Because inside the money finance government expenditure increase, there is also the component of the fiscal stimulus, which is characterized by a crowding out effect on civil consumption. Also in this simple model, because there is an upward pressure on the nominal interest rate, which justify the minor optimism of savers with respect to borrowers. I suppose that I can answer in this way.
I invite for other comments on, or questions on Q&A.
I don't know if I have answered
Waiting for other, I just have a clarification about the link between helicopter money and in the zero bound scenario and the impact on consumption and inflation. Can you clarify better these two different impact of helicopter money policy in the zero bound scenario?
Okay, simply the helicopter, maybe it's better to precise what is a zero lower bound scenario, in the sense that we have, normally we have an adverse demand shock, which pushes the output and the input response in a negative territory. So then we try to see if there are some policies able to prevent this recession. And 1% of money is not enough, exogenously given, it's not enough to prevent this recession. So this is the reason why a 1% increase of government expenditure require an amount of money also due, and we see in this last also due to the presence of heterogeneity, because otherwise, if we consider a representative agent in Keynesian models, also money finance government expenditure increase is not enough because it requires an amount of injection of liquidity which is not enough to prevent the recession. That only this measure in presence of a two agent in Keynesian model is able to prevent the recession, while the dynamics of an helicopter drop are the same as normal times in the case of.
Maybe Chiara, I can try to give an answer. Yeah. When we have a zero low inbound, the economy is firstly hit by an adverse demand shock, so output and consumption usually go down, and depends on the response of the policy. Is the policy is able to prevent, as Chiara said, if the policy is able to prevent the recession. When we have a government finance fiscal stimulus, indeed, there is an increase in the expenditure that enters directly the aggregate demand. So it's able to prevent the recession because the government spending to enter directly into the aggregate demands affects inflation, and this affects the reaction of the interest rate and saver and borrowers. Instead, when there is not demands government expenditure, but only an increase in money by the same amount of the government expenditure, but they are just transferred to households, this transfer to households are not directly in the do not enter directly in the aggregate demand. It's a standard Keynesian results. So the effects on inflation is lower, and also on the real interest rate on the response of consumption is, and this kind of measure is not able to overcome the recession. And also there are precautionary savings reasons for this type of household that prevent to yeah. the economy go in the liquidity trap.
Thanks. Just an additional comment, because one of the possibilities to apply helicopter money is through digital money. that can have also a deadline to an expiring time to this push to consume in a few weeks or few months the money. So maybe this can change the results in also in your approach. But I move to another comment, second one, by Donato Masciandaro. Is it possible to say that if we call your interpretation of the Galli framework a fiscal dominance regime a la Sargent and Wallace, your model is a monetary dominance regime?
Okay, I leave the floor to Lorenza. If
no, the main objective of the paper and related to the COVID was to show that if we are really in a zero lower bound scenario, if the real, the interest rates are at the zero, the lower bound, then a government expenditure finance through money is much more effective than poor helicopter drop. So I don't know if in this way we can.
The difference with respect to Galli is the fact that they want to evaluate fiscal money financed fiscal transfer, while we want to evaluate an helicopter drop. And it's not the same thing if we impose the constraint that Galli imposed, because Galli analyzed the money financed fiscal stimuli, imposing what we have imposed to analyze a money financed government expenditure increases. So the real public debt change. Obviously, an helicopter drop does not imply this. It's only a transfer of money, a direct transfer of money to households without any role of the government. Then an helicopter drop has also an effect on public. So at the end, yeah, there is a central role of fiscal budget constraint in the Galli analysis, also when he analyzes transfer, while there is not a central role at the starting point of our analysis when we analyze an helicopter drop, a central role of the government at the starting point when we analyze an helicopter drop.
And maybe to answer to the question of Donato, maybe we have a monetary dominance in normal times and fiscal dominance in a zero lower bound, but it was also necessary to be financed through money. So, and also other questions coming?
Yes, another participant has two questions. Considering the literature that demonstrates the optimal monetary and fiscal policy combination to get out of recession, in what sense do you think this paper is related to that literature? And the second part, just for clarification, does government expenditure in your contextual definition include also government investment?
No. Yes, it is related to this literature, and the second answer is no. At the moment, it's just for public expenditure. It's not for investment, or even if it is in the agenda, because the results would be even more on our side. Because if we have an increase in government expenditure, the multiplier will be even higher, and then the results will be reinforced. Chiara.
I leave the floor to you about optimal monetary and fiscal policy, because you are the expert. So I totally
expert pass on
this on this answer.
It's too much.
No, I was reading this the last one about the issue.
Yeah, another participant asked as a premise, maybe not some parts, but you said that in normal times, of course, monetary policy is effective in stimulating growth, while in zero lower bound, it gives worse results compared to fiscal policy. What about redistributive effects? Is fiscal policy always losing compared to helicopter drop?
Yeah, this is the results of our paper, in the sense that
we did not analyze well for a zero lower bound. Maybe if the question is
we haven't analyzed the welfare in zero lower bound.
For the moment.
We can answer to this question simply by showing that
the distributive channel is on the other way around, no? With the helicopter money from borrower to saver, and with the money final fiscal stimulus the other way around, so the result will be different with respect to normal times, I guess.
At the end, the fiscal policy is the loser when we talk about normal times, while when we analyze zero lower bound time is the winner, the fiscal policy, because simply there is an injection of liquidity, which is the endogenous with respect to the exogenous fiscal shock. What transforms the fiscal policy in the winner in zero lower bound times. So, but the answer to this last question of Silvia is our result at the end.
At the moment, we don't have other comments and or questions. Waiting for an eventual other or more questions and comments, I have a questions not strictly related to the paper. You mentioned it, Chiara, at the beginning about the policy news also in the European context, but the two policies that you compare strictly sensu are out of the European possibilities. Do you think just now and maybe possible in the medium-term future? What is your opinion on that?
I think that because I see from the question that there are also many heterodox economists, I have to say that the endogenous money is an issue that heterodox economists proposed for a long time and studied a lot also during my master's. So I think that and now this idea is also analyzed in mainstream models. So I think that to analyze this policy in 2014 was very predictive. So I hope that European institution will consider not a pure money creation, but also that investigating on these policies, which now is considered illegal in our jurisdiction and in many European country and in many Western country jurisdiction, can be also taken under consideration by economic analysis in central banks and European Central Bank. Also because, also for example, Monacelli has said in a recent article on La Voce, this can be a dangerous policy, also if it's a permanent policy. But if it's a temporary policy, there isn't the risk that it can threaten the credibility of a central bank, especially in a moment of crisis in which the alternative can only be the increase of public debt. This is what I think. And obviously my thought is from the organization for what I know.
So my answer is instead very short, because my answer is now or never. So,
okay.
And we'll see. Also, our results are strongly related to results on inflation. And also another question that I was expecting from the floor was, if they were implemented, do we expect inflation to rise really in the medium or long run, at least, or in the short run? We all hope that inflation will come at some moment to help us with the public debt and and also with the redistributive effects. So This is an open question.
Yeah, the increase of inflation of a money finance fiscal stimuli.
We should not have fear of inflation in this moment.
Yeah.
We need some inflation, not too much. But
not too much, yes.
Not inflation. Not inflation.
But maybe the answer is that what also Donato Masciandaro tried with the answer with his paper. So it's
especially
the issue is political. So it's not only.
Especially in a moment in which the worries are on redistribution and inflation can be an helpful instrument also to solve the main issue of this moment, so which is redistribution.
Not even too much.
Yes. Thank you very much. So I think we can conclude. We are more than 1 hour, so it's the perfect time to conclude. I just, before giving the conclusion to Alberto Zazzaro, president of the Italian Economic Association, I just recall that the next 2 weeks we'll have two other webinars, July 9 and July 16. Then we will continue on September, October. So a lot of submission of proposal by many economists in this kind of successful format of webinar of the Italian Economic Association. Alberto Zazzaro now concludes the webinar.
Thanks, Marcello. I don't have too much to add. I thank Lorenzo and Chiara for their very nice seminar. And that's all.
Okay.
Bye to everybody.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you.
Bye.
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 Thank you so much.